Hello, everybody. Welcome back to our podcast series on the category of Ancient Wisdom Demystified. Today's topic is the Babylonian Epic of Creation. So, Tata, what is this epic?
Well, this epic is called Enuma Elish. Enuma Elish means as above in Sumerian.
Okay.
And it basically consists of 7 clay tablets.
Okay, that's quite cool. So, yeah. What was the Enuma Elish?
Yeah, Enuma Elish is basically the creation story of both how the heavens were created and how the human beings were created. These are the last tablet basically deals with that one. We'll see that one okay. in a little more detail. First, let us look at what are the chief characters in the mythology.
Okay.
Now, we had 2 main characters to start with. Apsu and also Tiamat. Apsu was the absolute order, or okay. what they call as a clean water, from which all creation came. But creation cannot come without the female element. So Tiamat was the female element, and she had full potential, all type of potential. That's why she is called a salt water. And they were the gods of the deep. They were the forefathers of all gods. Because in Sumerian, Babylonian, Akkadian mythology, you had, like in many other mythologies, you had many gods.
Okay.
Among them was Anu. He was very important from our story point of view, which we will see further.
Okay.
He was then known as the Lord of the Universe. And he had 2 sons who were really primary, because he had many children, but 2 sons, Enki and Enlil.
Interesting.
So, they created a lot of gods there together, who? Apsu and Tiamat.
Mm.
But these children, the gods, they were very clamorous, very noisy.
Okay.
And they disturbed the, father.
Okay.
So the father was very furious. He said, what to do with these fellows? So he consulted Mumu, the wiser, the counselor.
Okay.
And asked him what to do. Then he said, why don't you just destroy them? Because you had the power to create. Why don't you just kill them off? Well, this was being contemplated. Enki overheard the plan and he crafted a spell to put Apsu to sleep so that he will not get into the act.
Okay.
So that Apsu went into a trance, and what Enki did was he stole the halo. You remember this point very well, because he stole the halo and put it on himself. And what he did was, he chained Tiamat, because she was mainly responsible for the children.
Yeah.
So, she has chained her so that she will not get into any other funny type of act.
Okay. Who did he get the halo from?
Apsu.
Okay.
Apsu.
Okay.
The father who was the, first god of...
So, he put the father to sleep and tied the mom up.
Yeah. Tied the mom up, and he got the, halo and put it as his crown. Now, Enki heard that Tiamat was not going to be lying quite chained. She was planning to have a revolt.
Okay.
So, he went to his grandfather, Anshar, and asked him, what do I do? This lady is very powerful, my grandmother. So, what do I do? Then Anshar suggested that you consult your own son. Your son is Marduk. Marduk is a very powerful god. So, you consult him what to do. Then he consults Marduk. Marduk says, don't worry, I will take care of all these things, provided you make me the king. He said, okay, fine. So, using the 4 winds, Marduk attacks Tiamat.
Okay.
And Tiamat is, so very infinite in her potential. She opens her mouth and tries to absorb all the 4 winds.
Oh.
But she's not able to do it. She becomes distended. And what this man does is, Marduk, he fires an arrow at her mouth.
Wow.
And it goes right to her heart and then puts her to death.
Damn.
So, this is the story of how Marduk slain both his father as well as his mother and took over the lordship.
Okay.
So, he became the sort of...
King.
King. So, then what happened was... Marduk didn't remain quiet. He split Tiamat into 2. One, he made the heavens. The other one, he made the earth.
Oh.
Now you can see a similarity between the, you know, creation in Genesis and this one, where God divided the heavens into one upper region and the lower region of the earth and the other things which are here.
I'm getting reminded of is more of like the Greek mythology kind of.
Yeah, it's also through Zeus.
Yeah, Zeus, his dad, like the Titans and stuff. Gaia.
Gaia and all that, yes, very true. So, Marduk made the likeness of all the gods because he had completely chained them and then into stars.
Okay.
Then, what happened was he created the night and day and then he created everything. All the creation story goes around saying the Marduk is the architect or the chief creator. Then, Marduk spoke to Enki and then he told him he would use his blood to create man.
Okay, now...
Yes, yeah. Now it gets interesting. How man was created out of, in God's image.
Yeah.
Is being reflected here in this 5000 BC. Old story, the Babylonian mythology. And he said, these people who I'm going to create will serve you. Because basically what happened was, Enki was a man who was going to look after the earth. Enlil will look after the heavens. So he created a special planet where he could house all the gods, Anu, Enki and himself, Enlil. And Marduk would be the ruler of the earth. So, but he had to create man in God's image. So what he did was he took the blood from Enki and used it to create the human beings. To serve them, not to give any other power, just to be servants, to be slaves. Then what happened was, then you go into tablet 7, that's the last one, where you find that a detailed description of how the whole of the planetary system was put into control. In 126 verse of the tablet 7, it says, he created Nibiru.
Nibiru.
This is another planet he created, or another abode, a star, which will be the one that will be shining in the sky and will be the controller of all things that he had now created upon this particular sky. And he constantly will be crossing the sea, the ocean of creation, and without resting. So he will be in constant orbit.
Okay.
Now you can get the idea of what it is, you know. Then he says...
I'm getting two ideas of what it is, it could be.
Let him be... called Nibiru. So, he will grasp the middle and control everything. That means, we'll come to this later, he will have control over what and how he distributes his own creation. Let him fix the paths of all the, you know, stars of heaven. Then, let him shepherd all the gods like sheep. The language is different, but you'll see. Then, let him buy Tiamat. Tiamat is not dead. She's only bound and then split into two. And put her to put her life in mortal danger.
Okay, intense.
To generation yet unborn, it says, to distant future days, may he continue unchecked, may he persist into eternity. This is the creation story of Enuma Elish, seven tablets.
Okay. So, nice. Like, what is like that cosmic meaning behind it actually?
That is very true. See, if you now look at cosmology, it is now discovered very recently in the last probably about within 50 years, 50 to 100 years, that how the solar system was formed is because we had a star.
Yeah.
Which was actually... a third generation star. Already it had lived three generation, fourth generation star, which is our sun. Now, the sun that is there, that is named Apsu, or the forefather.
Okay.
Because from the sun only everything comes.
And
Tiamat is a representation of what we call as the protoplanetary cloud, which is all completely distributed, you know, waving.
Asteroids.
No, asteroids don't come there. Still, they are all you know, mostly gas and particles and rocks which are all going around.
An artist's impression of the protoplanetary cloud with the sun in the center approximately 4.5 billion years ago. And you could see the capture of the mythology here with Nibiru attacking this cloud and using its fragments and associated comets and asteroids to break up the large planet, which is Tiamat, into two parts and thus launching the orbit of Earth and the Pluto.
Then gravity starts pulling them together.
Funny how gravity works.
now you can see that all the characters there are, this Nibiru is now what NASA is trying to theorize could be the ninth planet, which is, goes in a very elliptical orbit and makes probably once in 10,000 to 20,000 years an orbit around the sun. Now you can now see also our relation to the flood story. Because 10,800 years back, we had a visitation of a comet. Now, when Marduk comes around, he brings his army of people. Who are these armies? Various rocks and meteors and comets which are around Marduk, which comes around. Actually, this is more explained in what we call as the War of the Gods by Zakaria Sitchin.
Okay.
In one of the experts on translating the cuneiform Sumerian text. He has written about 6 or 7 books. This book completely details how the planets are representation of the various gods. And then as the Nibiru comes around, what happened in one of the orbits? It hit a big protoplanetary planet. There was only Tiamat, there was
Apsu.
And then you had this big planet ring getting formed. And this was hit actually by the planet which was much outside. It was coming through, it was being attracted by the sun. Apsu is attracting this one. And he comes into Tiamat. Tiamat is the disorder. And he hits that big planet which is there, which is a representation of Tiamat in disorder. Because there is no specific orbit. This planet is going all over the place. And then this comes and hits it and splits it into two. One becomes the Earth,
and the Gaia.
The other one becomes Pluto.
Pluto?
Yes.
Hmm.
A small portion of it is pulled out to Pluto. This is one of the theories.
That is.
And you know why? Because Pluto is the only planet which is going in a very half a sad orbit. In fact, it is outside the orbit of Neptune, but also come into the orbit of between Neptune and Uranus. So, this has got a very peculiar elliptical orbit. So, this is all mapping with what this particular mythology tells us. And added to that, you find that why does the Earth has got tectonic plates? Only planet to have tectonic plates.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
No other planet has got tectonic plates. Could you imagine why? Because this Nibiru came and hit it so hard, it broke up the surface into fragments. But it was held together because of its gravity. It was still, getting formed. So, you have a very hard or very liquid core.
Yeah.
And then you have the plates on top of it. And you find a big dent on the Pacific Ocean, right? It's very deep.
Compared to any other
part of the
sea. Yeah.
So, now you can see the whole mythology being connected to this one. How Nibiru came and hit this planet and ultimately Earth was formed and Pluto was ejected. And all the little fragments that were there, the soldiers around Tiamat who came to fight, they were all scattered into the asteroid belt.
Whoa.
You see the beauty of this?
Yeah, yeah.
So they were able to understand this deep cosmology, 5000 BC, and they wrote this one, which means these people who wrote it, the Anunnakis, were a very intelligent, very knowledgeable race.
Crazy to think about, because they could not have even They didn't have any instruments to look outside,
no,
right?
We think they don't have the instruments to look outside, but their Nibiru, the planet from which they came, and which is, you know, we don't know what type of technology, because definitely now you go back to your pre-Yanga Dryas days, you find that the technology was very advanced.
Mm-hmm.
We will see about it in the next episode as part of part two of the, you know, the Babylonian myth of creation of man and how these people came into being.
Nice.
So that is the story. Okay.
Okay. I guess that was a good episode. Yes.
Yeah.
We will see you next time.
Sure. Okay. We'll see you next time.